this is Jean Marie Ward for Buzzy Magazine. With me today at the Baltimore Book Festival is Marissa Meyer, the best-selling author of The Lunar Chronicles. Welcome, Marissa. Cinder, which is Cinderella. Scarlet, which is Little Red Riding Hood. And now Cress, on which you take on Rapunzel. What prompted you to transform the fairy tales of our childhood into dystopian science fiction?
Well, I have been a huge fan of fairy tales my entire life. When I was about 5 years old, I got to go see my first movie in theaters, which was Disney's The Little Mermaid, and I completely fell in love with it and have kind of been interested in fairy tales ever since. Not only the Disney movies, but, you know, delving into the Grimm classics and Hans Christian Andersen, etc. And so I always loved retellings. When I was a teenager, I got really into Gail Kirsten Levine and Shannon Hale and some of these great retellers of these classic stories. But I always kind of had this feeling that I did not want to write a retelling of my own unless I could come up with something that I felt was truly unique. I didn't want readers to pick it up and think, oh, it's just another Cinderella story. And so that kind of was with me for many years. Until one day I entered a writing contest, and the girl who was hosting that contest had made a list of about 10 things, and you had to choose two things from her list and include them in a short story. And the two things that I ended up selecting were to include a fairy tale character and to set my story in the future. And for that contest, I wrote this futuristic retelling of Puss in Boots, and I had so much fun combining, you know, this talking cat that was now a talking robotic cat, and a lost princess who was actually from the moon, and, you know, spaceships and hover cars and all these fun things. And I came away from that thinking that this was a great concept, and I couldn't find that anybody had really done it before. And so with that, I started just to brainstorm, you know, what else can I do combining fairy tales and science fiction tropes? And my imagination ran wild from there.
Cool. Did Star Wars play any part in that?
Oh, absolutely. Star Wars was one of my childhood loves. Han Solo was like my first dream boyfriend. And so Star Wars was always a really big influence for me. A lot of, you know, my influences on the sci-fi side are more of the space operas. You know, Star Wars, Firefly, there's this great anime called Cowboy Bebop. They're very character-centric, and, you know, play around with really fun world-building and whatnot. And so that was really the angle that I was coming into sci-fi from, as opposed to, you know, more classic sci-fi with lots of hard-edge technology and whatnot. So I think that influenced a lot of the world-building that I've ended up doing in the series.
Very cool, and a great shout-out to Cowboy Bebop, which is one of my favorite series. Anyway, you set stories in places like New Beijing, and that means your characters tend to be a lot more diverse than the long-suffering good girls and charming princes we remember from the fairy tales of our youth. Why is this important to you?
Yeah, I mean, diversity right now is such a hot topic in the young adult world. There's this great movement called We Need Diverse Books that, you know, seen a lot of outreach lately. And that I do think is definitely having an impact. Just if you look at the recent books that have sold and that are coming out in the coming years, you're seeing a lot more diversity in our literature, which is fantastic. For me, when I started writing this series back in 2008, I was not really thinking, you know, what big influence could this possibly have on people. I just knew that I wanted to write a futuristic world that felt authentic, and obviously we are not all white in the world, and so it would have felt very unreal to me to try to write a series of characters that were all white and all like me. And so I wanted it to have a very global feel, and that went along right hand in hand with including a lot of diversity. On top of that, I am a total geek. And one of my really geeky reasons for wanting a large cast of characters with a lot of diversity is that I used to do a lot of cosplay. And I remember having friends who, you know, were African American and Asian and whatnot, And we would want to do these like group ensembles of our cosplay when we went to the anime convention. And it was so frustrating when we wanted to do, you know, a beloved show or movie, and my non-white friends didn't have any characters that looked like them. And so coming from that geeky side, like, I want anyone who loves my books to have someone that they can relate to on that level.
That's very cool. Also cool is the fact that you've gone on record about your love of fan fiction, both as a reader and a writer. What role did fan fiction play in the development of the Lunar Chronicles?
Well, so I wrote fan fiction for the Japanese anime Sailor Moon, which was kind of how I got started writing seriously when I was 14, and I wrote it for like 10 years and dozens of stories in this world and with these characters. And it was hugely influential to me just because, you know, even though I'd grown up wanting to be a writer, fan fiction was the first opportunity that I had to share my writing with the world and start, you know, becoming a part of this community and having feedback and, you know, other strangers in the world reading my work and giving criticism but also encouragement. And that really pushed me a lot in those early years to not only keep writing, but to start seriously considering if this was something that I thought I could make a living out of someday. And I like to think that even if I hadn't had that community, I probably still would have written, I still would have tried to become a writer. But I think having that backbone and that community encouraging me over the years really influenced me to really go for it.
Very cool. What's next for your characters and for you?
Well, in 2015, I have two books coming out within the Lunar Chronicles. In January, the prequel novella called Ferris will be out. It takes place about 20 years prior to Cinder and is focused on evil Queen Lavanna, and will uncover some truth about her, what is under the glamour, and why she is so fascinated and obsessed with ruling Earth. And then in November of 2015, the epic conclusion of the series, Winter, will come out. That one is based on Snow White and the Seven Dwarves and will include all of our major characters as they attempt to take down the evil queen and save the world.
Then after that, though, you've got another series percolating. Can you tell us anything about that?
I do. I have two additional ideas in the works right now. In February of 2016, my first non-Lunar Chronicles novel will be out. It is called Heartless, and it's a young adult fantasy prequel to Lewis Carroll's Alice in Wonderland, all about the infamous Queen of Hearts. So I'm having a lot of fun with that because it's Wonderland, and I get to bring in all of these beloved characters and have a lot of fun asking myself, who were they before Alice showed up? After that, I'm about to embark on a new series. I'm writing a trilogy all about superheroes and supervillains and the gray lines in between.
Oh, very cool. Is there anything you'd like to add?
No, I don't think so. I mean, I love all my readers, of course, and I just want to say thanks to everyone who has read the series and been enjoying them and helping to spread the word about them.
Great. Thank you so much, Marissa, and thank you for Buzzy Magazine.
Thank you.